Details exclusively coming to you of Dawood's entire UK empire. The large number of luxurious properties that the Underworld Don has really amassed over the years in the United Kingdom. The entire list of them now coming out for the first time on Times Now. Detailed list really of all the properties that Dawood Ibrahim has. Let's go across to Nikunj Garg for more on the story. Nikunj, for the first time, the details of all of Dawood's luxurious properties here on Times Now. Can you take our viewers through the details of these properties?
Well, yes, these are the property details that have been collated by a multitude of Indian agencies, starting from the Research and Analysis Wing, then to the Enforcement Directorate, corroborated by the Ministry of Home Affairs, and you know, multiple sources over the years, from the bankers to the house broking agents to the brokers, sub brokers, etc., etc. Registry papers of these properties have been, you know, scrutinized, have been sifted through these individuals. Statements recorded by various law enforcement agencies, including some of the UK's law enforcement agencies, and then finally a very conclusive, exhaustive list was drawn. This process was completed, Madhav, I must tell our viewers, in 2015, and this list was for the first time exchanged when Prime Minister Modi made his maiden visit to UK as the Prime Minister of India. At that point of time, United Kingdom assured that, you know, a little more verification of these lists and this processes would be required before they start taking action. Sometime back in the last fortnight, they seized the first and the only foreign asset seized of Dawood Ibrahim and his gang in United Kingdom. And post that process, India has once again written, and that is why we are putting this list out in the public domain again. At that point of time, obviously, this was not in public domain so much as it was exchanged between the two governments. This time, we are putting it out in the public domain for the consumption of our viewers also, because now this list is almost a public document, and the UK government and its agencies have started seizing properties. Just a fortnight back, they seized one Midlands mansion, valued in billions of the company, and the other property. Properties, of course, are also under the hammer now and are just on the anvil of the law enforcement action being taken against them. So you can see the exhaustive list, billions of dollars invested, billions of UK pounds actually invested in buying real estate in some of the plushest and the most expensive localities of United Kingdom by Dawood Ibrahim and Company, which the government of India has zeroed in and wants clear action taken against. At least those properties should be frozen, as in the UK legal terms.
Right. Let's also go across to Danish, who joins us live for more on this from London. Danish, very clearly, of course, as far as this particular property is concerned, we know that action has been taken. But what about the large number of other properties that Dawood enjoys or at least owns in the United Kingdom?
Well, yes, as we just heard from a colleague, it's a huge set of properties spread across London, spread across UK. And in fact, right now I'm just outside a property in central London. You can't get central than this. It's known as the number 15 to 17 St. Sundin's Lane property. And what we gathered here is that that was big. Very long time, and now apparently it's being developed into a hotel. Now that is the on-site activity, but we know that behind that is basically the detail about that land was given by the Enforcement Directorate and several other organizations to UK to take action. But just to get a sense of this particular property, this is very close to Liverpool Street, which is the bang center of London. And this property, which is facing the road, is of course very, very prime. It was lying vacant for a long time and it was occupied by a bank. That's what we have gathered here. And then for a very long time, there was no activity there. But now what we understand is that a hotel is expected to come up. But we know that this was one of the properties that was that on the list. So of course, the government must be keeping a tab. They will be knowing who the developers are and how will they now take it forward.
All right, stay with us, Nikunj, as well as Danish. I'll toss over to Anand, who has more details of these properties that Dawood owns in the United Kingdom. Over to you, Anand.
Well, thanks for that, Madhav. And Nikunj and Danish have been getting us the details. Danish is standing in front of the property that perhaps is listed number 12 in this list that I have at this point in time. Just going across to the ones that are listed. Now, these are the properties in the United Kingdom, from London and across, even in the Highlands and the Midlands, across the United Kingdom, some posh properties. These addresses have been traced to the Herbert Road address that comes across. Listed at this point in time. There is also the property which is traced to Sarah House. There is 9 flats and a penthouse at 13B Richmond Road, Ilford. Now, that's property, that's number 3 that's been attached. Number 4 is the address that's been traced to Dartford Hotel. Now, Dartford Hotel is 22 to 26 Spittal Street, Dartford. Then property number 5 is 2 Thompson Road in Chigwell. IG7, and this is 5QW. That's the exact address of this property. Then you have property number 6, which is at 15 Rockhampton Street in Rockhampton, London, SW15, 4HT. That's the exact address. Again, these are all very, very high-value properties which have all been attached and all directly associated to Dawood Ibrahim. The other one is these are shops and apartments in Lancelot Road in Ilford, 1G6 3BE. That's the address. And there you go. This is the other property, property number 8. This is at 9 Combe Street, Romford, Essex. So you have properties in Essex. You got and this list is 15. I'm just sharing the first 8 with you right now, Madhav. We will also put out from 9 to 15 that list. And I think in that list, number 12. That's what Danish was talking to you about. And that's the one in Swithin's Lane, London, 15 to 17. And this is like the heart of London, as central London as it can get, Danish. And Madhav, back to you.
Well, absolutely. In fact, a massive property list over there, as you were mentioning, Anand. Let me quickly go back to Nikunj and Danish, who are, in fact, still with us. Nikunj, the fact is that these are all high-end, top-end addresses, as Danish and Anand have been sharing. Clearly, of course, all of this information is there with the UK authorities. What are your sources in the government telling you? We've, of course, made a start, but how long will it be before the other properties can also be proceeded against?
Well, Madhav, the laws have to be aligned, and thankfully India's new Prevention of Money Laundering Act, which has been operational only a few years, is now on most counts matching up with the UK stolen assets law. They have a particular law dealing with, most of the European jurisdictions have a law called stolen assets laws. So these laws have to align, and then only a criminal case of money laundering and siphoning can be proven. And once those cases are proven, those cases are established against such an entity, a company, or an individual, the assets can be frozen. Even the assets in terms of bank deposits or bank account holdings can also be frozen. Forget about the fixed assets, which are, of course, much easier to freeze. So they have made a beginning. I'm quite sure that Government of India, diplomatically and legally also, both is leaning very heavily against the UK authorities. And they are also trying to, go as fast as possible under their own jurisdictional laws and under the laws that prevail in the United Kingdom, which, of course, any freezing of asset can certainly be challenged in a court of UK. So therefore, they have to take, the Home Office has to take precautions on that front also in the United Kingdom. But nonetheless, the cooperation is at a fairly decent pace, and the Government of India certainly expects that more would come out in terms of choking the financial lifeline of the company and his assets globally, particularly in the European jurisdictions.
Well, absolutely. Let's go across to Danish as well, who's still standing by with us. Danish, very clearly, of course, the question that Nikunj was addressing over there was the fact that now the legal framework, the legal structure is in place after the bringing in of PMLA. And clearly, of course, the kind of legal hurdles that would have perhaps been there, say, a decade ago are no longer existent. What are your sources in the government of the United Kingdom telling you? Is this just a start? Are we going to be seeing more enforcement action on part of the government of the United Kingdom?
Well, what we understand is that the Scotland Yard has a separate proactive money laundering investigations unit, and they look after these cases. Of course, we should also remember that London by itself is virtually a center for investments from people all over the world. So it's not a problem that India faces. This is also something that a lot of ill-gotten wealth from the Middle East, from China, from Russia, you have all those oligarchs and people in smuggling and different nefarious activities choosing London as a safe destination. So the UK government is very much alive to this problem. They're very responsive. They have acknowledged at different stages the fact that London is used, or rather can be used, as a center for investment. Now, once that is established, and that is something which is, you know, the UK authorities are very responsive to, India now has to continue with the follow-up and ask them questions at regular interval, of course, supplying them with all the required information. And UK government here will definitely take some concrete steps, because as I said, it's not just about India. For them, London is something which is used by smugglers and people who have ill-gotten wealth to invest and transfer their money. Now, we know that Dawood Ibrahim also has used a lot of aides who have helped him,
right,
you know, in different parts of the world, including UK. So to answer your question, yes, the UK government will definitely take this matter forward. India has to keep the pressure up and keep supplying them with information and more details.
Right. Stay with us, Danish and Nikunj. Let me also go right back to Anand. Anand, more details of properties, I understand, are there as part of the list. Can you take us through them, please?
Yes, and the more we look at the addresses and the properties, the more startled I am. Look at the wealth that this person has amassed, and that is a link that draws him back to India, because unless he had the patronage and the blessings of the powers that be over the last so many years, this man wouldn't have amassed so much of wealth. Look at the wealth that these guys have. We stopped at Taunton Road. Now, this is the address in Romford, Essex. Look at the house that he has, the property, and this is what the address that it leads to. The address is, Romford, Essex, RM77DL, property number 9 on the list. That's what we are reading out. Now, moving on to property number 10. These are the lawns, the 74 Shepherds, Green London. Lovely, lovely little property, and very plush, isn't it? And this is the address. That's how it reads, the property. The lawns, 74 Shepherds, BUSG, and then it says Green London, W12. Property number 11 is 37 and 37A, Great Central Avenue. This is South Ruslip. That's the address, that's how it reads, and this is how beautiful it looks. These are all posh, plush properties that are all belonging to Dawood Ibrahim. And property number 12 in the United Kingdom, 15 to 17, Swithin's Lane, London, EC4N8AL. That's the address there. And look at the property. Now, you've just seen this visual. And now let's just cut across to Danish Khan.